The book of Genesis. Jacob loves his second to youngest son, Joseph, more than any of the others, and he gives him this special jacket. And the 10 older sons come to hate Joseph, and so they kidnap him, and they plan to kill him, but instead they decide to just sell him into slavery in Egypt, where he ends up in prison. Talk about family failure. But God is with Joseph, and he orchestrates Joseph's release from prison, and Pharaoh ends up elevating Joseph to second in command over all of Egypt. And so Joseph saves the nation of Egypt during a famine, and he also ends up saving his brothers and his family from starving to death. And so once again, we can see the folly and the sin of Abraham's family is met with God's faithfulness, who subverts even the evil of the brothers into an occasion to save life. And this is actually what Joseph says right near the end of the book. He says to his brothers, "You all planned this for evil, but God planned it for good to save many lives." Now, these words are strategically placed at the end of the book because they summarize not only the story of Joseph and his brothers, but the book as a whole.
What's up, guys? Welcome to the final week of Waitlisted, where we've been talking about waiting and waiting and more waiting. We've heard that God has a plan, but you might have to wait for it. We've heard that while we're waiting, God is faithful. And we've heard that while we're waiting, God is listening. This week, we're gonna look at someone in the Bible that did a lot of waiting. And while he was waiting and waiting on God, he didn't give up. And that brings us to this week's big idea. While you're waiting, don't give up. God wants you to know that there's a huge blessing coming to those that hold on. So even if you're in a struggle right now and you can't see God anywhere, there's hope, so don't give up. God is still there, and he still cares.
Like a flood, heaven come down over us, wash us clean by the blood Jesus poured out all for us. Fall away. will call your name. There is no other, then all before us fall away. Until there's only you, and all the earth will call your name. There is no other, then all before us fall away. Until there's only you, and all the earth will call your name. There is no other, then all before us fall away. Until there's only you, and all the earth will call your name. There is no other, in all our grace. We're yours forever, our God and King. There is no other, with all our grace. We're yours forever, God and King. There is no other, let all before us fall away. Until there's only
Only 273 more days to go. Can you believe it? Can anyone guess what I'm waiting on? I'm counting down to Christmas morning. What, too early? When do you start counting down to Christmas? Okay, maybe it's weird to start counting down to Christmas with 273 days to go. So tell me, when do you start counting down to Christmas? Maybe you're a July person. Too early? What about Thanksgiving? How about the 1st of December? Some of y'all are like, nah, man, December 23rd is when I start counting down for Christmas. Well, if you love Christmas, when you're waiting with excitement for Christmas morning to arrive, the waiting can be painful. Am I right? But you know what's more painful than that? When life has you waiting for so long for things to change. It can leave us feeling like we want to just give up hope. And maybe you've been trying hard, but nothing seems to change in your life. Maybe you've tried to make wise choices, but the people around you don't seem to support you. Maybe your family is a mess and it doesn't seem to get any better. Especially when we feel alone, unsupported, or even abandoned by others. It's not always easy to believe that we can keep going when we've already spent so much time waiting for something to happen. Well, there's someone in the Bible who understands this very well. His name is Joseph. Yeah, you might have heard of him. He's the guy with the special jacket. And he's a pretty important person in the Bible. Now, you might be familiar with Joseph's story, but let's go ahead and get reacquainted with our friend Joe. All right? So this is Genesis chapter 37. I'll start reading in verse 2. It says this. When Joseph was 17 years old, he often tended his father's flocks. He worked for his half-brothers, the sons of his father's wives, Bilhah and Zilpah. But Joseph reported to his father some of the bad things his brothers were doing. Jacob loved Joseph more than any other of his children because Joseph had been born to him in his old age. So one day, Jacob had a special gift made for Joseph, a beautiful coat. But his brothers hated Joseph because their father loved him more than the rest of them. They couldn't say a kind word to him. One night, Joseph had a dream. And when he told his brothers about it, they hated him more than ever. "Listen to this dream," he said. "We're out in the field, tying up bundles of grain. Suddenly, my bundle stood up, and all of your bundles gathered around and bowed down before mine." His brothers responded, "So, do you think you will be our king, do you? Do you actually think you will reign over us?" And they hated him all the more because of his dreams and the way he talked about them. Soon, Joseph had another dream, and again he told his brothers about it. "Listen, I've had another dream," he said. "The sun, the moon, and 11 stars bowed low before me." This time he told the dream to his father as well as to his brothers, but his father scolded him. "What kind of dream is that?" he asked. "Will your mother and I and your brothers actually come and bow to the ground before you?" But while his brothers were jealous of Joseph, his father wondered what the dreams meant. Wow. Man, so Joseph was his dad's favorite son, and it was pretty obvious. Jacob loved Joseph so much that he gave him that special coat and special treatment. And you can imagine how awkward that made things between Joseph and his brothers, right? To make things even more awkward, God began speaking to Joseph in his dreams, letting him know that he would one day rule the nation and rule over his brothers. Now, instead of keeping this information to himself, you know, it's questionable, but Joseph shared it with his brothers, which made things awkward. Instead of taking the hint that his brothers didn't appreciate being told that Joseph would one day be their boss, Joseph continued telling his brothers about these visions from God. Of course, things got even more intense. When Joseph's brothers finally had enough of Joseph talking about his awesomeness, they decided to get rid of him. At first, they planned to kill him, but one of the brothers convinced the others to spare his life and sell him into slavery. Now, can you imagine what Joseph must have been experiencing when he realized how much his own family hated him? When he realized that he'd be thrown into a foreign country where he didn't know anyone? What about waiting to find out where he'd end up and how he'd be treated when he arrived? Well, that's enough uncertainty and loneliness to make most people give up hope altogether. But that's not even the end of Joseph's misfortunes. When he arrives in Egypt, God gave Joseph tons of incredible opportunities. And things probably seemed to be looking up for Joseph. But then, well, let's just read it. This is Genesis 39, starting at verse 1. It says this. When Joseph was taken to Egypt by the Ishmaelite traders, he was purchased by Potiphar, an Egyptian officer. Potiphar was captain of the guard for Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. The Lord was with Joseph, so he succeeded in everything he did as he served in the home of his Egyptian master. Potiphar noticed this and realized that the Lord was giving Joseph success in everything he did. This pleased Potiphar, so soon he made Joseph his personal attendant. He put him in charge of his entire household and everything he owned. From the day Joseph was put in charge of his master's household and property, the Lord began to bless Potiphar's household for Joseph's sake. All his household affairs ran smoothly, and his crops and livestock flourished. Wow. Potiphar noticed how God was with Joe, so he put him in charge. But you know what? Someone else noticed Joe as well. It was Potiphar's wife. Verse 8 says this. But Joseph refused. "Look," he told her, "my master trusts me with everything in his entire household. No one here has more authority than I do. He has held back nothing from me except you because you are his wife. How could I do such a wicked thing? It would be a great sin against God." So Joseph refused her, and this made her angry. So she lied about him. That's jacked up, and even more than that, Potiphar didn't believe Joe. So verse 19 says this. Potiphar was furious when he heard his wife's story about how Joseph had treated her. So he took Joseph and he threw him into the prison where the king's prisoners were held, and there he remained. Now, just when things were beginning to look up for Joseph, he faced a new set of difficulties. Can you imagine what Joseph must have been experiencing when he was being preyed upon by powerful people, when he had no one to turn to, when he was abandoned by the people that he thought were his allies, when he realized that he was going to be thrown in jail unjustly? Once again, that's enough to make most people give up hope altogether. If you were Joseph, what would you have done? Give up? Punch someone? What about trust God? This wasn't even the end of Joseph's misfortunes. Joseph continued to live in that prison for years, forgotten by Pharaoh and his own family. Joseph even had a chance to be freed at one point, but his opportunity was lost, once again, when Joseph was forgotten. Now, I won't tell you how the story ends, so go read for yourself in the book of Genesis. It's an amazing story. But today, we're talking about what to do when you're sitting in the dark, waiting for help, looking for hope, uncertain about your future. When Joseph was in this position, he had every reason to give up and lose hope, but he didn't. Even though everything seemed to be going wrong, and Joseph wasn't sure if he'd ever make it out of prison, or if God would ever fulfill the promise of making Joseph the ruler of a nation, he knew that God was still with him. While he was waiting, God had a plan. While he was waiting, God was faithful. While he was waiting, God was listening. In all that time, God never gave up on Joseph. So Joseph never gave up on God. And if you're waiting on God right now, don't give up, because God's not giving up on you either. Now you might be thinking, well, this sounds good, but how? How do I not give up hope? How do I find hope when things feel hopeless? How do I hang on when I feel like I'm all alone? Here are four ideas that can help you. First thing, talk to God and don't stop. Like we talked about last week, tell God how you feel and what you're experiencing, and then ask Him to help you hold on. Talk to other people. Joseph may have been abandoned and alone, but you're not, even if you feel that way sometimes. You may have friends and family and a church filled with people who you can talk to. If you're feeling overwhelmed or feeling hopeless, talk about it. Remember, God is stronger than you could ever think. When Joseph was sold into slavery, he could have never guessed the opportunities God would give him in Egypt. When he was in prison, he had no idea what God had in store for his future. When he was betrayed by his brothers, he could have never anticipated the way that God would one day restore their relationship. God did all those things and more, and He's the same God who's telling you that He's bigger and stronger than you think. Last thing, choose hope. Hope isn't just something that happens to us. In many ways, it's something we can choose. We can choose hope when we fill our minds with what's good and what's true. We can choose hope when we choose to talk about our struggles rather than trying to handle them alone. We can choose hope when we tell God how much we need help. We choose hope when we decide not to give up, no matter what. So what have you been waiting for? And how are you going to not give up? Will you talk to God? Will you talk to someone you trust? Will you remind yourself of God's strength? Will you choose hope? As we close out this series, I hope you find hope in the stories we've shared about the men and women who waited on God. Abraham and Sarah reminds us that God has a plan, but we might have to wait for it. Paul and Silas reminds us that while we're waiting, God is faithful. David reminds us that while we're waiting, God is listening. And Joseph reminds us that while we're waiting, we can't give up, because God's not giving up on us. So no matter what you're waiting on right now, keep going, because God's not finished with you yet. Hold on, because you're going to see a breakthrough. Let's finish by reading Galatians 6, verse 9. It says this, "So let's not get tired of doing what is good. At just the right time, we will reap a harvest of blessing if we don't give up. Let's pray. God, we thank you so much, Lord, that you are stronger than we could ever imagine, Lord, that even if we can't see it right now, you're with us, Lord God. And you're telling us that a breakthrough is coming if we just hold on, if we just have hope. So today, Lord, help us to choose hope, Lord God. Help us to see that you're stronger and more powerful than we could ever imagine, Lord. And that you're with us, God, throughout all of our struggles, Lord, and you never leave us. So today, God, we choose hope, and we're waiting with expectation at what you're going to do in our lives. We love you, Lord, and we trust you today. In Jesus' name, amen. What's up, guys? Welcome to this week's Middle School Challenge. I've invited Pastor Kalen to come and try to get another W in the column for her. And so we're gonna do something with these air cannons. As you can see here, we have these cups. Yes. And so basically, once we start, whoever knocks all the cups over with the air is the winner. Pastor Kalen.
Yeah.
Are you ready?
I'm as ready as I'm gonna be.
Let's do this thing.
Let's do it.
Here we go. We're gonna do the best 2 out of 3. I got that one. Pastor Kalen, don't worry. We're gonna do another.
Okay, so as you may or may not have been counting, I certainly have. I won the first 2 challenges I was a part of, and Pastor Kalen won the last 2 that we did together. So he won the first one of this, and I can't lose this round. Otherwise, I'm like the loser.
Guys, I took that one this week. That is 2-2-0. My air cannon worked a little bit better than Pastor Kalen's this week, so I got this one. There'll be other chances, guys, but that's this week's Middle School Challenge. Hope you enjoyed it. Hope you had a great week, and we'll see you guys on the Flippity Flip later.